Hey everyone, it's Rob with Four Songs. So it's Christmas time, and while this is not necessarily a Christmas episode, believe me, you'll be finding out that it is the gift that will keep on giving. Before I get to it, though, let me paint you a bit of a picture. Pretty much all my life until I got out of college, my parents used to take us up to Toms River, New Jersey every Christmas. This is where my mom grew up, and so we'd see her parents, so, you know, my grandparents and cousins and aunts and uncles, and you know, it was a lot of fun if you were a kid. And then, you know, every day after Christmas, my dad would take me and my cousin and sometimes my sister out to Seaside Heights, which if you've ever seen the Jersey Shore or seen that show, Jersey Shore, you know what I'm talking about. The big boardwalk, lots of games and rides and kind of tacky, you know, can get out of hand. It's kind of a crazy place. But if you ever go there in the wintertime, it is just the complete opposite. A lot's closed, but just enough is open to make it worth your time. You got arcades, you have a little Santa's Village. It's really something else. And when you're there by yourself, practically, there is something eerie and something calm all at the same time about it. You know, there's always been something a little strange about going to the beach in the wintertime. And I don't know, maybe because I did it so often as a kid, I just like it. You know, there's no tourists, unless you count us, because we weren't from there. But there's really no one around. There's no one to butt in front of you. There's no one to wait to finish that video game. And sure enough, all those games are still there. You can play Donkey Kong all you want because no one else is going to play it with you or try to keep you from playing or get in your way or hog you the time. Anyway, that's a long-winded way for me to get to this episode. My guest this time is Nicole Atkins. And Nicole is one of the most, I know I say a lot of great things about my guests and I mean all of it, but Nicole is something else. I've been listening to Nicole since about 2007. She actually comes from this part of New Jersey. She's from Neptune, which is a town just a stone's throw away from places like Asbury Park or Point Pleasant or Seaside Heights, these Jersey Shore towns. And I think that explains why her music sounds the way it does. There's something eerie, but something calm, something haunting, but something beautiful about it. Her voice just carries over it all. And she's also incredibly diverse in the kind of music she plays. She can rock out, or she can sing cabaret. She can just about do it all. I really had a hard time describing her, and as you can tell, I'm kind of all over the place in my accolades, but believe me, once you hear her sing, if you haven't heard her already, you'll know what I'm talking about. So it was a tremendous honor for me to speak with her in December from her Nashville home. So she's now in Nashville, no longer in New Jersey or Charlotte, where she was based before. She is promoting her latest album called Memphis Ice, which is a piano string-soaked, stripped-down version of her 2020 album, Italian Ice. Now, Italian Ice was released in the midst of the pandemic, and during last summer's racial justice protests. The album itself is like a trip through time along the Jersey Shore. You can hear some disco, you can hear some big band, you can hear some Springsteen from Greens from Asbury Park. It's got a lot in it. It's an escape, and you'll get lost in it. Memphis Ice, on the other hand, was recorded live one day in, you may have guessed, Memphis, Tennessee. And it is about as intimate as you can get. A piano, some strings, and Nicole. You can close your eyes and envision her singing this in New York, Chicago, Paris, any great city, in a dark, smoky club. She calls it her Judy Garland moment, and boy, does she deliver. We talk about four songs from the album, Domino, Mind Eraser, Captain, and what might be my favorite song of the year, Promised Land. Now, three of those songs, Domino, Mind Eraser, and Captain, appeared in very different form on Italian Ice. She saved Promised Land for this because it's so stripped down and so bare that it just fit. And in this interview, she talks about what it took to take those big-sounding songs from Italian Ice and to strip them down to the bare minimum for this album. And we talk about her process for writing in the first place and how her hometown still seeps into her music. Now, what's funny was as we were talking, Nicole told me that her home was filled to the brim with boxes of the vinyl copy of Memphis Ice. So, yeah, you can get this on Spotify or iTunes or however else you get your streaming music. But if you really want to hear it, if you really want it to blow you away, you've got to get it on vinyl. You can order it directly from her website, and guess what? She ships it directly to you from her home. And she'll tell you, you never know what you might get if you do that. So it's worth it. You know, as I've made pretty clear, Memphis Ice is a masterstroke, and it is my tremendous honor to welcome Nicole Atkins to Four Songs.
Fire away, sir.
All right. So, well, thank you, Nicole, for joining me for this episode. I'm really excited about having you here, so thank you.
Yeah, me too.
Well, so first question I've been asking people, and I've been doing this for almost 2 years now, which is hard to believe, mm-hmm. but I started this right when the pandemic was just coming around. So how have you managed the last year and almost 2 years now?
You know, what's wild is like, I talked to a bunch of friends about this. It's like, when you think about 2 years, we're like, where did it go? It went so fast, you know? I manage pretty well. My husband is, he works as a tour manager and a front of house person for bands. And so we actually got to spend a lot of time together, which you never do. And that was really fun because we started a variety show in my attic and he did the sound and our neighbor did the camera work. So it was kind of like a dream project because all of the special guests, none of them could say no. Because
right.
I was like, come on, I know you don't have shit going on. Like, and so they all said yes. And we got to do some comedy bits and play the songs. And, you know, I'm just kind of like a giant kid. So I'm used to being able to entertain myself. And then it ended up entertaining other people too. So that was great.
So how has this, the last, it seems like, you know, maybe 4 or 5 months ago, vaccines are rolling out and things are opening up again. And now we're sort of in this weird, maybe not, but time of this pandemic. And how's this, I mean, what's it like for you as an artist, just to kind of feel like these stops and starts and like, we're going to get started up, no, we're not. And then, yeah, it's,
well, I think,
it's agonizing.
You know, being in the music industry now for almost 18 years, it's taught me a lot of patience. You know, like in the beginning, I would always be like, oh my God, this needs to come out now. What? Like everything's going to go away. And I think, you know, just some time and experience. And then with the pandemic, it's taught a lot of people that, you know, you can only control the art making. You can't control the other things that happen because that's when other people get involved and not everybody's on the same timeline. And I think we're seeing that, you know, the earth does not abide by our timelines. So it's not up to us. I think that whole, you know, acceptance is your friend thing. Mm-hmm. It's really real. You know, once you can accept that things are the way it is, it just frees up yourself from fighting against it. And you could just go back to making your stuff.
Yeah, well, that's a good perspective. I mean, I'm wondering, I know Memphis Ice. Go ahead.
It's taken me a long time to get there.
Yeah.
But, I'm glad I'm there.
Yeah, I mean, especially, I mean, I must have just been, I mean, touring is the lifeblood of a musician, and it had to have been just like, ugh.
Yeah, but you know what? Like, once we, like, the second variety show stream I did, my grandfather passed away, and so I did a few songs that night for him, and just seeing my family on the chat, on the YouTube, I was like, one, holy crap, they learned how to use YouTube. And two, it was like, there's people on the other side of that lens, you know? So while you're doing that show, it really feels like you're together, you know? And we missed touring. And once we got to go back to touring last year, it was really great and it felt better than ever. But it's also, you know, taking this into the future, how do you tour smarter and not, you know, just kill your body just to be out touring? Like, there's other things you can do.
Well, we're here to talk about Memphis Ice. And so this podcast is about songs and songwriting. And I'm just so thrilled to talk to you because I've been listening to your music back to the beginning, Neptune City. And then,
nice.
Yeah. I mean, Goodnight Rhonda Lee, I just thought was just tremendous. And
thanks.
And then Italian Ice, which you were talking about earlier, that was like, to me, that was like a trip through time. And
yeah.
So, and you've made no secret of the influence of your hometown, Neptune and Asbury Park have had on your music. And was fortunate, my mom's from New Jersey, and I spent my very young preteen years going to Seaside Heights and Point Pleasant.
And nice.
Yeah. And I mean, I know the lore of that.
What was your favorite boardwalk game?
Oh gosh. I like the spinning, even though I never won. The big wheel and then the frog bog.
Frog bog. That was my favorite too. I also like you shoot the water gun at the clowns and blow up the balloon.
Yeah.
I was really good at that.
Yeah. I was better at, well, I mean, the wheel is, it's all chance, but
it's all chance, but they had the best prizes.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, but the lore of that, I can remember being in Lavalette as a kid, and that's just far enough from the seaside where you can see the lights and when I listen to your music, I feel like there's so much going on in there. And so how did that lore, that era just influence your writing?
Like, I think as an artist, you know, growing up there, it's hard not to be inspired by the landscape, you know, like in the summer, all the lights go up, all the tourists come down, and it's just like a giant party for 3 months. But then everybody goes home, and the people that live there year round, you know, it's like this deserted beach town with the river, and it gets, you know, pretty romantic in a way, if you can think your way into it, rather than just being like, it's cold, no one's here. But I would always just let my mind wander and just come up with like stories and, you know, different scenarios with what I saw around me. And I'm still able to do that, not even living there. It's just such a great well to draw from.
Mm-hmm. So when did you start writing songs?
I didn't start writing songs until I was 21.
Oh.
I always played music. I always played guitar, sang cover songs, and, you know, I had a couple bands, but I always thought it was a daunting task to try and write a poem that went with a song. Mm-hmm. Until I moved back home to New Jersey after college, I ran into the guy that owned one of the music venues called Saint in Asbury Park. It's like a little dive. It's like the CBGBs of Asbury. And asked him for a gig, and he told me that they no longer let people play cover songs, and did I write my own music? And so I lied to him and said yes. And he gave me a gig, and I had to write, you know, 40 minutes worth of music. And it was like, once I had a task, and I always knew that I would, I just didn't know how or when. And then it was like, you know, the songs just kind of poured out of me, and I was able to write about my time in Charlotte and write about, you know, I didn't start writing about Neptune City until I moved back to Charlotte in 2003 and was living in a warehouse. Like, I'm always like able to write about things after, not while I'm in them. The only record I ever wrote that I wrote while I was in it was Goodnight Rondalee.
So, and how do you know, like, when did you realize that you're playing those, you're writing those songs for that gig? I mean, when did you realize that, hey, I'm good at this and let's make a go at it?
Well, I was playing in an Irish pub. I had like an Irish pub gig every week. I did one of my own songs. Somebody asked who wrote it, and I was like, me. So that's when I was like, you know, maybe these are good. But I also thought, like, when I was anytime I write something that I can't wait to share with friends, and I write a lot of songs that no one will ever hear. But when I have one that I'm like, ooh, I can't wait to like show a friend, that's when I know I've written a good song.
Well, I mean, I like I said, I've been listening to your stuff since the beginning, and that's just, I love it. So
thanks.
Well, we'll talk about Memphis Ice, and we're going to talk about four songs in particular.
Okay.
Captain, Mind Eraser, Domino, and Promised Land. And the first of those three were on Italian Ice with the full band treatment, as we were talking about earlier. And Promised Land didn't make it on the first album, but thankfully is on this one. So,
yeah, Promised Land, I wrote maybe in 2012 with Angelo Petraglia during a trip to Nashville. And I was living in Brooklyn at the time and going through a breakup that was like, we broke up that day over the phone. And he was like, oh, I have this chorus. And he sang me the chorus. And I was just like, okay, we can definitely write that together. And we just wrote it in like a couple hours. And it was one that I remember the label I was on was like, okay, now write 10 more of those, you know? And it's like, you can't, that's not how it works.
Right.
And so I'd always try to record that song with a band, and it just always ended up just too much, you know, because that song is just like, it like sounds like a hit, you know. Mm-hmm. But there's a fine line when you record it with it being cheesy and a good song, when it's a song like that. And it was always when it was more stripped down, I felt comfortable with it. So when this project came up to re-record Italian Ice's Memphis Ice, I was like, this is the perfect scenario to do this, because with piano and strings, like, it'll just give the song, you know, the space and the elegance that it needs.
Chinatown. I came by to hear you singing, but I couldn't get through the crowd. There's so much I need to tell you.
I just, when I heard it for the first time, I was just blown away, because it just, it reminds me, and this, I don't know what you think of this, it because it doesn't have that Motown sound, but it reminds me of the song "Every Little Bit Hurts."
Ooh, who sang that?
It's it was never a big hit, but Brenda Holloway, I think, did it, and Gladys Knight did it. This is probably in the 60s, I guess. And then,
very cool. What's this title again? Because I'm gonna
"Every Little Bit Hurts."
Cool.
And well, the reason why I mentioned it is because I
love the title already. So.
Yeah. I grew up listening to The Clash a lot.
I love The Clash.
Yeah. And so they actually do this unreleased cover version that, of course, made it all their greatest hits. Well, not the greatest hits, but some box sets or whatever. And
cool.
It's just Mick Jones singing. And, you know, Mick, I love him, but he doesn't have, he wouldn't be go down in rock history for his voice, I don't think.
No, but, you know, if that's a song that he feels, you know, yeah. Like that, when you pick a cover song, it's like you're compelled to do it because you're like, I that song knows me somehow.
Yeah.
You know, and you make it your own, whether it's a, you know, a great rendition or if it's just a scrappy rendition. It's nice to know what people love.
Yeah. And I feel like the way he sang it reminds me of how you sing this song. And there's an emotion that I feel like is, it just feels like this song is, maybe because it would be a very personal song. And
yeah, it's a song that, you know, you're just really almost kind of exhausted by the situation that you're in and you can't do it anymore. And like somebody else's idea of like, oh no, like this is going to be great. You know, like you don't, for me, like I don't want to be on the ride in a relationship. I want us to be riding together. And that was the point of it, you know, it was like, just feeling like you're just along for the ride in somebody else's world can be really lonely.
We're broke down from where we stand. I see trouble in the promised land. I see pain and I see hurt. And what's it really worth? Darling, don't you understand? You can't drag my heart to the promised land. Can't drag my heart. Bet you're smoking in the alley at the cabin down.
Yeah, but like toward the end, the line is, we can't sit together because you're lonely. I feel like that, you know, it's so relatable, because I feel like what's so true about that is that's hard to know when you're in that kind of.
Like, and it's, yeah, and it's hard to get away from too. I remember the breakup that I was going through. I knew that we weren't right together, but like I just, you know, it was almost like I was talking about myself. Like I didn't want to, you know, break up because I didn't want to be lonely, you know? And I think that's a good thing, you know, it takes with time, but the best, you know, tool somebody can have living as a human is learning how to be alone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because it's not that bad. It's kind of great.
Yeah, it can be, but yeah.
It can be, yeah.
Yeah.
Trouble in the promised land. I see pain and I see hurt. And what's it really worth? Darling, don't you understand? You can't drag my heart to the promised land. Can't drag my heart. You can't drag my heart. We're broke down from where we
stand. So this song fit well because of doing everything so stripped down. But when you were going to the others, how did you decide which songs, because not everything made it from.
Yeah, the ones that we kept off were AM Gold and Never Going Home, because those songs just, they were such, the guitar and the beats were very integral to those songs. So we kept them off because, and I thought that Domino and like Mind Eraser, like, how's that going to work? Because, you know, the beats are so integral to the songs. But once we got in the room, it was like, oh, wow, like Domino, like sung in this way, feels like a warning. I always feel like an actor when I'm singing the songs, and in this format that we did Memphis Ice in, I was able to really like go there as, you know, as a singing storyteller. It wasn't meant for, you know, we didn't have to worry about like, how is this going to sound on the radio? It was like, how is this song going to relate from me to the person listening and watching? And after we did that, I was like, I want to do this all the time.
Well, I love that you kept the riff from Domino, because that, I mean, that's just killer.
Thanks.
Watch them fall like dominoes. I don't wanna play safe and sound when the world comes tumbling down.
So when you're doing that, kind of taking it from the slick guitar, kind of that slicker version to this, like what goes into that, which I know that's a very vague and non-detailed question, but
I think it goes back to acceptance. You know, you have to accept this is what you have to work with. It's a minimal, you know, you have these three elements that you can work with. So how do you find a way to make it work? And you have to adjust your phrasing, or you have to adjust, you know, what mood you would have based on what the music is telling you to feel. So that was where I got to it from. You know, we had one day a rehearsal at my house, and a Mind Eraser just came together so easily. And that song I originally wrote with Carl Bremel from My Morning Jacket, just the two of us on acoustic guitars. And it was like, I thought it started out as a Roy Orbison type thing, the "These Dreams I Know Too Well."
If the first thought says my mind's erased, I never want to leave again. When you spend time in a lion's cage, you never go to sleep again.
I thought that was a chorus. And then he started playing it like with Radiohead chords under it. And I was like, whoa, this is a pre-chorus. you know, so then what's the chorus? And just, you know, we wrote it where he's playing guitar and I'm just pacing back and forth like a, you know, a weirdo chanting, you know, you get in kind of this like hypnotic kind of mode once you find your way into a song, and it's, and you kind of lose time. And afterwards I kept thinking of that Tender is the Night from Blur. And it was like, this, the song doesn't sound like that, but it gives me the same feelings as that song. So once we did it with piano and strings, like I wrote the string arrangements with Laura and Maggie and just sang them the parts. And I didn't realize that, you know, I always thought it was like the drums and bass that really made that song a thing. And then once we did it, just the four of us, I was like, wow, the string parts are like one of the most important parts of this whole song. So it just felt very easy to sing it and record it that way.
When you're surfing through a frozen wave, dunes piled high, ex-lovers waving bye. When you live life through a speeding train, you never see your home again. These dreams, I know too well, am I sleeping? It's hard to tell.
Yeah, I feel like this song is the one that stands out in terms of just how different it is. But it's still,
yeah, it's my favorite one that is on there, because you really hear like, you know, the Serge Gainsbourg influences and the piano and strings and the dynamics of the song.
Yeah, especially in that bridge.
Yeah, that bridge, like they came up with that. That Dan Chen was my first piano player in my band for a long time. And he and I just keep coming back into each other's worlds all the time. We have like an open door policy on our friendship and artistic, you know, collaborations. And I love that. And so we hadn't played together in 8 years. And when he played the middle part of Mind Eraser, I was like, oh, this is why I love Dan Chen. Cause like, he's the only person that comes up with stuff like that, that I know. It's just, it's dreamy.
There's a vacancy inside my head. You never want to leave.
It's exciting when you can strip everything back and it ends up sounding bigger, you know, and I think a lot of that lends to how I write songs. You know, I've always found the songs that I write kind of show tuney, and instead of, you know, shying away or covering that up, it felt really good to just let it breathe.
Yeah, I feel like that. And listening to it, it feels like when you were, you could be doing this in sort of like a Judy Garland type thing that she did in Paris.
That's exactly how I felt. Like, wow. When we were doing this, I was like, God, I feel like fucking Judy Garland right now. And like, if I just like, there wasn't a moment that I wasn't in it when I was singing it. And I always thought I'd have my Judy Garland moment later in life. You know, okay, I'll do that record when I'm older. But now I'm like, fuck it, I'm going to do it now. All the time, because it makes me, you know, really feel really present.
Yeah, well, because you've said in the past that some of these new songs feel old, and I think I know what you mean, because there is that kind of old soul sense to them. But the way you've done them here is, I feel like it's like brand new in a way too. Because
yeah, and I think it's a good thing to keep that kind of music from going away. You know, because I feel like nowadays in pop music, it's more about the producers than it's about the artists. So, you know, it's good to keep making things that keeps the focus on the songs and the artist.
Yeah.
And the audience.
But do you feel like when you're performing in this type of atmosphere, when it's so stripped down, do you feel like there's a greater connection?
Yeah, I do. You know, because I'm not getting lost in like the rock band treatment where I'm just like rock, 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 rocking out. You know, that's super fun. I love doing that too, but I'm glad I can do both.
Yeah. Yeah, because not everyone can. And I think that that's a sign of a great song is when you can do it different ways and almost get different feelings out of them too. Like
I equate it to like when I was born, like the first things I remember is Judy Garland and The Who's Tommy. So that really stuck with me and kind of never left being my two go-to modes of living is, you know, cabaret singing and rock and roll and trying, you know, throughout my whole life to combine those things.
Yeah. Right. I think you may have hit it here. I mean, with fun, it's on like Captain too. I mean, how did
Captain actually, I had that song in my phone and I was doing a different song with Carl right before we went to record the record. And I was like, oh, before I leave, what do you think of this? And I just thought it was kind of too simple because we finished it in like 2 seconds. It just like literally came together in 5 minutes. So I was like, oh, this song, you know, is probably a throwaway or maybe I'll work on it more later. And then my keyboard player Moose in Brooklyn was like, this is a perfect song. How did you do this? And it's, I guess maybe not being musically schooled. I don't know when things are sophisticated or melodically right. I just know if I like it or not. And, you know, he just went into this tangent about like, you know, the blah, 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 things I don't understand. And then I was like, oh. And then Britt from Spoon was like, how did you write this song? And I was just like, in 5 minutes. And we kept it on. It became one of my favorite songs on the record. So, you know, I think as a songwriter, it's good to show people your work because you never know what, like, something that you think might be whatever because it didn't take you very long or you didn't put much thought into it could end up being your best thing.
Yeah, I've heard others say that it's the songs that come out of nowhere like that.
Yeah, they're gifts.
Yeah. And I've tried to get people to explain, like, well, what do you mean? Because I have no idea what that feels like. So
yeah, like I was writing with a friend of mine, this writer, Emily Levy, and I just had this dumb, or, you know, it's not dumb, but I thought, you know, I just woke up and I was having coffee and just like sang this little thing into my phone. And she's like, oh, that's cool. And then she finished it. And it's like been in my head all week. So it's like, yeah, it's hard when you write a lot to focus, to know which ones to focus on. And that's what I think is like the great thing about co-writing, you know, because you can focus on a lot of things at once.
Well, and also like Captain, like how did that work? Was it lyrically? Did you work together with Britt or was it?
That was co-written by Carl Brummel too.
Okay.
And Britt sang on it. So Captain though, I had a verse, you know, I always have disembodied melodies in my phone and then scraps of poetry that I keep in a big, you know, file in my phone. And I remember calling Jim Sklavounos and being like, we don't have lyrics to this and that and the other. And he was like, well, do you write on the road? And it's like, I forget all the things that I wrote. And he's like, go through what you wrote already and see what works. And the, you know, the fake words thing when you're writing melodies is really good to do. You know, it was like, I could be your captain. I kept singing, I could be your captain for one. But like, that was an easy amend. I was like, for once. And then it was like, oh, that's what it's about. Like letting me, you know, take care of you for once, because you're always taking care of me. So I've actually written about my husband, because he's a tour manager and he's just always taking care of others. And, you know, he needs to take care of himself sometimes too.
Yeah.
A lot of people like that in our families.
Yeah. I mean, that can be hard, just as hard as letting go can be hard as knowing when to let go, because that's just
totally, especially if you're a control freak.
Right.
That's why I always love that movie, The Phantom Thread with Daniel Day-Lewis, where his wife has to poison him in order to so she can like take care of him.
Oh, God.
I always joke to Ryan that I'm going to do that. I'm not going to do that.
Well, what I really like about this song is, and I feel like this is a challenge for any writer, is to know when you've got it right and when to stop. And
yeah.
So how hard is that for you to do?
It's not hard for me to do. It's hard for me to do that with paintings. Can't tell you how many paintings I've ruined just by like doing too much, but with songs, I think I've really come to a place where I'm able to, you know, especially I always think in production and layers and, you know, when I have a song melody, I'll hear strings and backup vocals and everything at once. But I also know that throughout my life, I've had to do, you know, depending on budgets or radio things, I've had to do them stripped down too. So I think now going forward, it's nice to keep in mind, like, that I will have to do these songs stripped down. So what can we lose that doesn't serve the actual, like, you know, structure of the song? It's kind of the funnest part, slashing everything, getting rid of stuff, editing.
Yeah. Now, how much of that did you enjoy doing, taking these songs from Italian Ice to these versions of On Memphis Ice?
I feel like I already did that before I recorded Italian Ice. So it made this recording really easy. You know, it was a day of rehearsal and then straight into recording it in a day.
Wow.
I think it, you know, comes down to having great players and just being prepared. You know, like when we did Mind Eraser, the recording had a crazy bridge on it. Like a almost kind of like Beatles / Lemon Twigs kind of bridge. That was that way when we wrote it. And then Moose called me and he was like, you know, I don't want to talk out of turn here, but I made a quick edit of what it would sound like without that bridge. And when I heard it, I was like, oh my God, it's so much better now. Because that bridge is cool, but it takes you out of the mood of the song. And so maybe that bridge gets used somewhere else in a different song in the future.
Well, so speaking of players, so who's with you on Memphis Ice?
It's Dan Chen on piano, Laura Epling on violin, and Maggie Chafee on cello, and then Claire Reynolds on backup singing.
Well, as we wrap up, and thank you so much for your time tonight, Nicole.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it.
So what are your expectations now? So are you going to be hitting the road, do you think, in the next year?
We have a few festivals on the books. We're doing Keamo and the Avett Brothers on the beach thing in Mexico. So that'll be nice to, you know, work on my tan, play some music. And I'm just in writing mode for my next record, which is going to be, you know, it was inspired by the Memphis Ice sessions and the way that we recorded them. So I'm making a record of standards, but they're new songs that feel like Stardust or Crying or, you know, Break It to Me Gently, but they're new and they're about modern things, but spoken about in an elegant way. So they won't get dated.
Yeah. Well, can't wait to hear that. And then you also said you have a duet, album of duets coming out potentially.
Yeah, that's me and Jim Sclavounos. We're just called Nicole Atkins and Jim Sclavounos. It's a mouthful, but yeah, that record's finished and we're just making plans. So,
well, we can't wait to hear the new stuff and some emphasize.
I know, I can't wait to write it.
Well, so Memphis Ice is out and it's on vinyl and streaming. Will there be a CD release at all, or is it just on vinyl?
No. But if anybody wants vinyl, it does get shipped from me from my house. So, you know, we're keeping it totally in-house, and you never know what might end up in your package. Like, I just stuck a pack of Cat Muji post-it notes in somebody's. So lucky them.
Yeah, we can't wait to hear it. And thank you so much for your time tonight, Nicole. I greatly appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
So I'm just going to assume by now you've already ordered your copy of Memphis Ice and it's coming to your home, and maybe you'll get a nice little surprise from Nicole. Thanks again to Nicole for joining me. This was a tremendous episode and an honor to have her on. Hope everyone has happy holidays, and I got more stuff coming in 2022. So stay tuned, subscribe, share this with whomever you want, and thanks for listening. We'll see you soon. Happy New Year.